And the basis and the verse, the Course of Miracles is basically trying to get rid of every block that's inside of us to experiencing joy and love and happiness, and allowing us to let the normal joy and love and happiness that's in us to come out. Are any of you open to having any blocks to love removed?
Yes.
All right, now, so we know the only rule is you don't have to believe these ideas, you don't have to accept these ideas, you don't have to welcome these ideas. Some of these ideas are gonna be hard to believe, they're gonna be startling. You're not necessarily asked to analyze the ideas at all, but if you want to, you can. But it's the use of the ideas. If you use them, you'll see that they work, because it's really talking about changing my perception in order to keep my peace of mind. If I can keep peace of mind, I can hear my inner guidance. Each one of us have divine guidance, inner guidance that's guiding us every day, that's giving us the answer to every single thing we're wondering about. But the Course teaches that the reason why we don't hear it is we're listening to the voices we've made up. And those are usually the voices from the past, the voices that we've learned and the things that we've experienced since we first entered the planet. We make up an identity around that conversation, and we call that identity us, but it's really just nothing but a conglomeration of old experiences and beliefs all come together that I call my personality and what I believe is true and my concepts. And so the Course is basically trying to get us beyond the concepts that we have about ourselves to the truth about ourselves. And the truth about ourselves is that we're love. That's all we are. We're spirit. We're love. We're infinite beings having a human experience. We're infinite beings having a human experience. We're infinite beings having a human experience. And what's really a trip about it is like we are like actors who have gotten lost in their roles, and now we believe we're the roles we're playing. You know, so we've heard so many stories about what we are so much that now we believe it's true sometimes for ourselves. And basically the Course is teaching there are two thought systems, a thought system based on love and a thought system based on fear, a thought system based on unity, and a thought system based on separateness. It just breaks it down to two things. It also says basically there are two types of people in the world, those who take responsibility for their experience and those who see themselves as victims. Those who take responsibility and those who don't. So one person is increasing their empowerment by assuming responsibility, and the other one is decreasing their power by always projecting everything that's happening to them as being caused by something outside themselves. So when the Course talks about sickness, it's not talking about just a physical condition. It calls it non-right-mindedness or feeling a lack of peace. So the Course in Miracles has its own definitions for terms. So it's basically talking about love and fear. So when I go through this section, because I pull a section at random for each group that I'm going to teach, and I ask the universe to give me, to pick a section that's going to be for the people that show up. So the one that came up today was the end of sickness, which is the same as saying the end of fear, which is the same as saying the end of conflict. And so I'm going to give you the modern language translation of the Course, which simply means that I'm going to use the Course in Miracles definitions for the words to give you a variety of insight into it. Now, remember again that I don't expect you to agree with everything I say. You may not agree with anything I say, but you know what? It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. Because in the end, you're going to accept what's true for you anyway, as you should. You should follow your own inner guidance. But keep one thing in mind, new means different. And when you say you want to hear something new and you're ready for something different, it means that you have to be ready to hear something other than what you already believe. Most people listen with this attitude. What you say that I agree with is true. What you say that I don't agree with isn't true. So when they walk out of a room, they're essentially the same way they were when they entered into it, because they haven't opened themselves up to any other points of view other than the point of view they already had, and then they're looking for reinforcement of the ideas that they've already had. The challenge is, whatever your challenge is that you're going through, it's based on the way you already think. So if you want to have a different experience, the Course teaches you have to have a different perception, a different way that you're willing to look at it. Now, when you hear something that's truly different from the way you normally think, that usually brings up resistance. So resistance is a good sign that you're possibly hearing something that's different from what you already believe. So resistance isn't bad, resistance is actually good. So if I do this right, you may walk out of here today disorientated, confused, disoriented, confused, and asking why in the hell did I show up? Or you may walk away saying, I really heard something that was really cool today. All right, we cool with that? Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. All right, so the course calls Fear of Magic. And so I'm gonna, this first paragraph is very, could be very abstract. And so I'm gonna break it down. It's on page 187. Hmm. And first I'm gonna read through it. And when I read through it, you might go through what I call Course in Miracles disorientation, which means that it's gonna sound like I'm reading English, but it won't make any sense. If you got a problem with the word God, substitute whatever word you want to substitute for that. Higher power, love, spirit, universe, that's up to you. You just put whatever you need to put. It says, all magic is an attempt at reconciling the irreconcilable. All religion is the recognition that the irreconcilable cannot be reconciled. Sickness and perfection are irreconcilable. If God or the Creator created you perfect, you are perfect. If you believe you can be sick, you placed other gods before God. God is not at war with the God of sickness you've made, but you are. The God of sickness you've made is a symbol of deciding against God. And so you're afraid of your sickness or unhappiness because it can't be reconciled with God's will. If you attack your sickness or your God, your personal God, your personal idol, you will make it real to you. But if you refuse to worship it, in whatever form it may appear to you, and wherever you think you see it, it will disappear into the nothingness out of which it was made. So the Course is telling us that, first of all, you were created perfect. Now, what does being created perfect mean? From a Course in Miracles perspective, being created perfect means that you were created complete. And being complete simply means there's nothing missing in you. There is nothing missing in you. You're not going to be recalled. There's nothing missing in you. So first of all, you were created whole and complete, which means that everything you could possibly need to have a happy, fulfilling experience, you came here with it built into who you are. So if you were created perfect, the Course says, if you believe that you're anything other than that, that's you putting your own belief before the truth of who you really are. So if I'm really created as love, and I believe I'm no good, fearful, insecure, and lacking, that's me putting my belief in what I am before the truth of what I am. That which created me whole and perfect and loving. I'm coming up with an idea about myself that's less than that. And so the Course says, when you do that, it's not that your creator is at war with what you believe about yourself, but you are. So people are really at war with their own beliefs about themselves. You're at war, he said, we're at war with our own beliefs about ourselves. It's our own conflicting beliefs within our own mind that's causing our distress. So if I'm in distress and you're in distress right now, the Course would say the reason why that's happening is because you're in conflict with your own ideas. The ideas that you have about yourself are in conflict. And so it goes on to say, the truth is we know that seeing ourselves as less than loving cannot be reconciled with God's will, which is love. You are love. So the first thing that we need to do is come to the conclusion, the Course says, that you need to take a stand. Either I'm loved and I'm lovable, or I'm not. And if I make the decision that I am created as love, then what I should be doing as part of my personal growth work is getting rid of every idea and every belief that blocks me from recognizing that fact that I am love and I am whole and I am cool. So I want to get rid of the beliefs that keep me from knowing how cool I am. That's what my spiritual path is. I'm cool. And anything that's telling me that I'm anything other than that in my own mind is what needs to be released. Mm-hmm. And that's what the Course calls sickness. It's the beliefs that we have in ourselves that we're guilty, that we're separate, that we're not enough, that we're sinful. All of those ideas are ideas that's actually in conflict with God or love's will, because love's will is that you know you're whole and that you know you're complete, mm-hmm. and that you know you're perfect. Mm-hmm. That's what love wants us to know about ourselves. So the Course in Miracles says, well, how do you get past it? He says, well, in that very first paragraph, that if you just refuse to worship that idea in any form that it comes to you, that you're not enough, that you're lacking, that you're missing what's true about you, then he says, then it will disappear. So what's keeping my insecurity going? It's my focus on it. What's keeping my lack going? It's my focus on it. What's keeping me feeling like I'm not enough? It's my focus on it. So how do I get rid of that? Well, I stop focusing on it and start focusing on the truth about myself, and the untruth about myself will disappear, And then I will see my outer reality reflecting that love back to me, because my outer reality is a reflection of the things that are going on inside of me. In other words, your outer experience is nothing but a reflection of the predominant ideas and beliefs and feelings and emotions that you have consciously and subconsciously. The outer world is nothing but a reflection of what's going on inside of your mind. So if you want to know what's going on inside of your mind, it's how you're perceiving everything and everyone around you. That is your projection. That's what's going on inside your mind. Mm-hmm. Everything in the world is neutral, but you're deciding whether it's good or bad. You're deciding whether it's right or wrong. You're deciding whether it's going to bring you joy or it's going to bring you fear. You're the one that's giving it the meaning that it has for you, but everything is neutral. Yeah. Paragraph one. Any questions about that? Any comments about that? And like I said, so everybody basically got it. Okay, paragraph one premise is you are whole, you are complete. Anything that you're telling yourself opposite to that, that is your sickness. The way I get rid of that sickness is by not worshiping the ideas that limit me. If I don't worship the ideas that limit me, the ideas that limit me will disappear. What's the easiest way to not worship an idea that limits you? Focus on one that doesn't limit you. And that's what the Course in Miracles workbook lessons are doing. They're telling me, I am spirit, I am innocent, I am whole, I am complete. I could just as easily be thinking that as I could be thinking, nothing goes right for me, I'm lacking in some way, no one could ever love me, nothing goes right for me. Both of those are focuses. And if you focus on the lack idea, everything in your reality will reflect that back to you in your perception. If you focus on the truth about yourself, not only will you see the result of it, but the entire universe supports that premise, because that is the truth. So love supports the truth, but you have to uphold your negative beliefs about yourself, or at least get a partner who thinks that way about you so that you can feel bad about yourself. Yes. Or get a partner, or allow yourself to have a partner that reinforces the truth about yourself. So every relationship is either helping me believe more of the truth about myself, or every relationship in my life is helping me forget the truth about myself. But it's still based on what I want to believe about myself. Mm-hmm. So first I decide how I want to see myself. Then I draw to me the people, places, situations, and circumstances that witness it back to me. First I decide that I can't be loved, and then I attract the crappy people to prove to me that it's true. Then I decide I am lovable. Then I draw the situations and perceptions and people that see my value in my life. But they come after the decision I make about myself. So that means to me, no matter how you were brought up, no matter what your background is, no matter what your mama did, no matter what your daddy did, it doesn't matter. It brought you to this point, which you're sitting up here today, and you're hearing that you can change all of it by changing your mind. So you can either use all your energy reflecting back on everything you think was done to you, which means in that case you still want to perpetuate your pain, or you could use this time to ask yourself, what are the new ideas that I can now incorporate in my mind and apply to my life so I can get the new perception that I want? So that means what? It's time to let go of your story. Yeah. It's time to let go of your story. Your story served a really good purpose, but now it's time to drop your story, okay? You're more powerful than your story. How do you know you're more powerful than your story? You're here and your story isn't. You have to tell people about your story. Nobody knows about your story until you tell them. To everybody sitting up in the room, you, as far as they know, you could be a whole, complete, beautiful person. So either you're going to want to get a witness to that as being true by perpetuating your story, or you're going to start telling the truth about yourself so that people can have a new perception of yourself, and everybody else around you can too. Mm-hmm. But if there's a payoff in your story, and a payoff in your story that you're not ready to give up yet, you won't give your story up yet, because you'd rather have whatever that payoff is and being the little pitiful person that you see yourself as being than getting in touch with that powerful being that you are. How do I know that I still want to hang on to my story and the payoff of my story? I'll defend my story. Mm-hmm. I'll sit up here now and I'll defend my story. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you say, but that was something I went through that's making me the way I am right now. Well, what's cool about that is you can keep your story as long as you want. Nothing in the universe is going to try to take your story from you, and least of all me. I'm not going to try to take it. You have to ask yourself, do I really appreciate the life that this story is creating for me? The life that, or the situation that this story is creating for me, the financial situation, my relationship situation, my career situation, my spiritual situation, is all coming from my story. So then you ask yourself, how has my story served me, and is my story serving me? So don't defend your story. Just take a look at the result of your story, and then ask yourself, based on results, do you really want to keep this story going? When the new story that I'm sharing with you right now is the story of your perfection, the story of your completion, the story that you are loving, and the story that you are lovable, and you could actually be that way whether you believe it or not. So your belief has nothing to do with the truth of something, but your belief does have everything to do with what you see and perceive and experience. All right? So beliefs are not necessarily true with a capital T, but you will always see your beliefs and you will experience your beliefs. That's why beliefs are important. That's why I don't argue with people about their experience, because I know if they believe it, they're having that experience in their perception. You know, if the person who believes all men are no good is going to have a lot of relationships with what they call no good men, and then they'll be able to point that out to me. So in their perception, that's true, but they don't realize that no good men are ultimately rooted in their belief that they don't deserve to be loved, more so than the fact that all men are out to get me. I'm out to get myself, and I use certain men to do it. So all the loving men, I don't notice. Or if I do, I put them in the friend zone. And then the ones that give me the hard time, then I don't think I deserve a loving relationship, and I have this overwhelming physical attraction to them. You know, I want to get them as quick as I possibly can. Yeah, yeah. So sometimes you'll see there's a direct connection between passion and conflict. Mm-hmm. You'll find that people have the greatest amount of passion with the people that they get upset with the most. They get a chance to have make-up love, or make-up sex, or make-up whatever you call it, you know. And so when you make the transition from wanting that which does not give you fulfillment to moving toward that which does give you fulfillment, you'll be in an in-between period that it kind of looks like you're not particularly attracted to anything because you're in transition. So it's kind of disorienting. Now, my brother, what was your question?
Well, For a long time, I felt like I was doing everything alone.
Right.
I was very confident, very strong, very hard to break down. And then I found out that I didn't know everything. I learned that here. That was supposed to be a good thing. And I learned that I was love and try to live love. And I feel time periods of more incompetency now than I ever have in my whole life. And I'm so mixed up because I'm supposed to be feeling good, you know, and I let it go. I find a way to love myself, but I just sometimes I get overwhelmed feeling incompetent now.
Okay. See, now the Course in Miracles describes that. It says that you're going to have periods where doubt comes and goes, and when you're on the process of making the transition, you're going to go through disorientation and confusion. So actually, it's not saying you're going to feel good all the time. It's actually saying that you're going to remove the blocks to feeling good all the time. And part of removing the blocks to feeling good all the time is in that transition, you may feel disoriented. So the disorientation that you're feeling is a sign you have begun to let go of your hold on the old way of thinking and really have moved towards a new way of thinking. Part two of your comment is what I think is the most challenging part of all. See, many times when we come to classes like this, we're listening from the part of our mind that says, give me some more information so that I can handle my life better, which is a totally egotistical perspective. Because the spiritual perspective is about learning how to surrender and learn how to surrender to and listen to the guidance of your divine self. This class is not about making you more capable of doing things on your own. And the part of you that has that goal would not like this class. This class is actually based on the idea that we didn't create ourselves and we do have spiritual support and invisible guidance. So I'm not even trying to fake like I got a problem with the idea of God or higher power, because that's the other part of what you're saying. that becoming aware that you are not alone and that you have support on an invisible as well as a visible level is what will allow you to have more peace about the confusion that comes up. See, I don't believe I'm doing this on my own like I used to. I believe that I have something looking out for me, and I know it's true based on the experiences that I've had as a result. So therefore, I'm like a kid that feels like I do have a parent, but I'm not looking at it like in a traditional way of a big man in the sky with a beard, because I'm not that. I'm an infinite being. I'm a spiritual being inhabiting a physical body, learning lessons in love. So I'm no more my body than you are the clothes that you're wearing, okay? But I do have guidance. Something created me. And this book is about removing the blocks to you going within to hear the guidance from your own divine self. I keep saying that. It's not another book about how we can get more information so we can take care of ourselves better. It's not about that. That's not what the Course in Miracles is about. It's about giving you new interpretations of your experience that will allow you to keep your peace of mind. The goal of the Course in Miracles is peace of mind. And it says the peace of mind comes from you having an interpretation of your experience that makes you feel peace. Let me give you a quick example. If I told you that you had just taken a drink of water and I said, wow, I wish I could have caught you in time because I think there was arsenic in there. Okay, now you're gonna probably immediately go into fear, right? But if I come right back and say, oh no, it was the glass for my mother-in-law. now if I come right back and say that, you will immediately go from being alarmed to feeling peace again. What happened? You got a new interpretation. First, the interpretation was that you were drinking a glass full of poison. You got upset. Soon as I say it is not poison, like that, you felt better. Notice that your emotions were based on the meaning that you were giving. I've said it again. Your feelings were based on the meaning that you were given. First, the meaning was, I took poison, I'm afraid. The next meaning was, I didn't take poison, so I'm not afraid. So your emotions changed instantly. So the idea that we have no control over our emotions is not true. If you finally get that your emotional response is coming from the definitions and meanings that you're giving to things. Everybody with me on this?
Yeah.
All right, so then that means if you want to feel peace, it's theoretically possible for everybody in this room to feel peace anytime they want to. Why? Because each person in this room can change the meanings and interpretations that they're giving to everything that's happening to them, just like changing your interpretation of that being poison to not being poison, change you from fear to peace. All the other things in our lives that's upsetting us, we could change our interpretation of it so that we can maintain our peace. And then the minute we get our peace, then we can hear the guidance that we're being given about the situation. So I'm not trying to put you into my hands or anybody else's hands. This is not a class about follow me as the leader or anybody else as the leader. My purpose is to help you remove the blocks to hearing your own divine guidance so that you don't need me at all. That's my goal. So theoretically, what I'm telling you is that what you're going through is normal for a person to go through if they're doing serious personal growth work. And if you want to get back to that peace even faster, what I do is I dive into the Course even more than ever before. Whatever my spiritual path is, I go, well, I'm evidently not reading and studying and meditating enough, but I'm doing it a lot, but I'm not doing it enough. Because if I was doing it enough, I'd feel more peace. So that's good. Bottom line, that's good. And thanks for saying that. Thanks for saying that, because you were saying that for everybody. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Chris.
Earl, I want to make a comment because I'm starting to see that, like, at least for me, the way that I'm gonna apply the Course, because I used to like see it as an intellectual exercise. You know, if I could just figure it out and analyze it enough, I'll get it. But I'm starting to see that, at least for me, I need to bring my illusions to the truth. And the way that I do that is when I feel like the uncomfortableness and the stuff, I need to like open up to that and bring that to my inner guidance. Because I used to like use the exercises or the stuff in the course to like suppress those feelings.
Right.
And to like run away from those feelings.
Right.
And I thought that that was the way you needed to do it, but it keep coming back up. And I'm realizing that the way to the other side is through it, mm-hmm. by opening myself up. And it's not an intellectual thing, it's a heart thing, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really starting to see that, and you know, it is uncomfortable, and at times it's scary, but on the other side, there's so much freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly right, exactly. If you would make it okay not to feel okay on the way to feeling okay, you will feel okay faster. If you think you got to feel okay all the time, or you are somehow failing, then you're gonna have a really hard, unhappy journey. You gotta let go of this idea that you're gonna go from the most miserable person in some area to a happy person in some area without having some intervening sense of disorientation and transition. It ain't happening. So you need to drop that. You have to go, I am willing to go through what's necessary in order for me to reach this level of consciousness that I want to go through. And if you do that, then there's not a lot of resistance to the things that come up, so it passes quickly. But bottom line is, like I was telling, I did a workshop yesterday, and I was telling the people in the workshop that there's a workshop that I want to do, or a class that I want to do, that that the only people that can come to this workshop are people who are miserable. I want the most miserable people, the people who are the most miserable, to come to this workshop. Because people who are miserable get on it. They don't BS around. They go, look, this relationship was the most hellacious, worst thing I've ever experienced. I've gone through this enough. I can't take it anymore. Whatever it takes for me to change my mind, I'm willing to do it. So they're on the edge of their seat. They're not there to debate and argue with you. They're going, can you tell me something that's going to make some difference? And I'm willing to try it and to listen to it.
Yeah.
Okay? People who are sort of happy jive around a lot. Okay? You know, your relationship isn't the worst one in the world, but it's not the happiest one in the world. It's not the worst job in the world, but it's not the happiest job in the world. You know what I'm saying? So people in that state, they kind of philosophize and debate and try to figure out what they want to do, because it's not really a fire under their ass. You know what I'm saying? There's nothing really going on that's really moving them. So they'll go back and forth, like the frog that eventually dies because the heat is turned up slowly and they don't even know they're being cooked. All right? So then there are the people who have worked on the truth and followed their spiritual path, and their life is rocking. But they're smart enough to know that to keep it rocking, they've got to go in a maintenance program. Mm-hmm. So the more they can remind themselves of the truth, they're going to do it. So they're coming, not necessarily because I'm sharing something they've never heard before, but they're coming because they want to reinforce these ideas in their mind, because they know their reality is a reflection of their ideas. So they want to strengthen the ideas. I call those the maintenance program folk. And when you're in that kind of environment studying something, everybody in the room moves at a rocket pace, because everybody's dead serious about having to change more so than they want to defend their old position. And so I'm just curious to see what a workshop like that would be like. You know, with people who have actually like, I have had it, this is it no more. And those who are going, this is going good, and I want to keep it going. Because sometimes when people study the truth and things start to really work for them, they're like a person that's driving a car without continually putting fuel in it. And they're living off the energy that they created before, but they stopped doing their truth, and they stopped doing their studying, and they stopped doing it, because now they're too busy having fun with the manifestation that came as a result of working on themselves. So now they used to come to class, but they don't have time now. They gotta walk through the park with that lover that they met as a result of changing their mind. You know what I'm saying? It's like they're into the effect, but they're no longer focusing on the thing that created it to begin with. And so all of a sudden it dies, and then they go, what happened? And they don't realize, well, you didn't maintain the level of consciousness that created it in the first place. You didn't keep doing the thing that you were doing to make that change happen. That's why it died. You know, see what I'm saying? We don't breathe once for the day. We don't go, oh, I breathed. I took a breath at 6 o'clock this morning. I don't have to breathe no more today. But that's the way people look at it a lot of times when they're studying the truth or doing a spiritual path. Oh, I said my affirmation one time weekly, with no sincerity whatsoever, yesterday afternoon. Why is it my prosperity here? It's the same kind of thing, you know? So I'm just suggesting to you that the truth does work, but like anything else, you don't get anything more out of it than you put into it. But what's even better about it, though, is it comes back to you bigger than you gave it. That's my experience of it. All right. So I'm saying this because I want to remember it. I'm saying this so that I don't forget it. I'm teaching this so I can learn it. That's why I'm sitting here. Isn't it wonderful that some other people wanted to learn it too, so that we're doing it together? But I want you to be clear. Earl is teaching this class so that Earl can learn how to be more loving, more forgiving, see himself correctly. You know, that's why I'm doing it. I'm the learner as well as the teacher. And, okay? But I'm so glad I reached my limit and got sincere about it. Some people have a tolerance for pain that'll blow your mind. Their ability to keep dealing with the same thing over and over again will blow your mind. I'm gonna pass this around for my contact list if you haven't already signed it. I record all my classes and put them on YouTube. If you Google my name, I'll come up instantly, and I got 700 classes online. So why? So that you can always be supported in remembering it. I got all the course. I videoed all the Course in Miracles workbook lessons. There are 365 of them. Google, do my last name, Purdy, and then lesson, whatever it is you're doing in the workbook, and that video will come up. Or you can just do it every day as a way to start out your day. You know, why am I saying this? Because the way that you move to another level of consciousness is just what Spirit was saying. If you don't focus on that other stuff, it'll disappear. If you focus on the truth, then you'll see more of it in your experience. So the next paragraph says, reality can dawn only on an unclouded mind. Reality is always there to be accepted, but reality's acceptance depends on your willingness to have it. I love that. To know reality must involve the willingness to judge unreality for what unreality is. To overlook nothingness is merely to judge nothingness correctly, and because of your ability to evaluate what's nothingness truly, to let it go. Knowledge cannot dawn on a mind full of illusions, because truth and illusions are irreconcilable. Truth is whole and cannot be known by a part of the mind. So reality, which is love, can only dawn on a mind that is not clouded. And a cloudy mind is a mind in conflict and fear. So when you're in conflict and fear, you cannot recognize what the truth of a situation is. So you're most likely to be wrong in your interpretation of what's going on in your life when you're upset. So you're most likely to see something incorrectly when you're upset, where the average person thinks when they're upset is when they're seeing it the clearest. I'm mad, so I must be seeing this correctly. And the Course is saying, when you're mad, that's probably when you're seeing everything incorrectly. So what you learn to do after a while is, when you feel angry and upset, you try not to make any decisions or choices until you allow yourself to get more into a space of peace. The average person wants to have a conversation when they're most upset. A conscious being doesn't want to have a conversation when they're upset because they know their perception is wrong. So they want to do some work on themselves, get to the point that they have some inner peace, then say, hopefully within 24 hours, let's sit down and talk this out. An unconscious person goes, don't you walk away from me. You know, baby, that's the smartest thing I can do is walk away from you right now. That'd be the best thing I could do for both of us, is for me to get away from you just a minute and ask for another way to look at things, and then we get back together and discuss this. But the ego is not going to do that. The ego is going to say, let's sit down and talk this out when both of us are so crazy and our anger is, we're both going to say a bunch of stuff that we wish we hadn't said later on. So a conscious being knows that they want to get to a centered place before they communicate, where an unconscious being always wants to try to communicate when they're most upset. Then it goes on to say, reality is always there to be accepted. The love is already there to be accepted, but acceptance depends on your willingness to have it. So if I want to have something, I've got to be willing to accept it. So let's do a little small indication of what that's like. If I give you a compliment, your willingness to accept it is what determines if you have it or not. So kind of practice when people acknowledge you in any way to not have a comeback that disempowers what they just said. Oh, me? No, that can't be true. Oh, no, I'm not like that. I don't believe that that's true about myself. You could really have an incredible experience if you just say, thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you. I appreciate that. You know, you're an incredible group of people. Thank you. I appreciate that. Oh, no, I couldn't be. What are you talking about? You look beautiful today. Oh, no, I don't. Did you see? You know what I'm talking about, right? You know people that whenever you try to say anything loving to them, they're so busy deflecting what you just said that you stop doing it. And then they get upset with you about not complimenting them enough. And they don't realize how many times they've said, don't compliment me, don't acknowledge me, don't compliment me, don't. Why? Because every time you do, I deflect it, I belittle it, I make it not real. So these are little simple things that we could do starting today that would make the difference. The course also says, if you're getting information and guidance from your true inner guidance, it's going to have two characteristics. One characteristic of your true guidance is that it's going to be something that you understand. And that's simple for you. And it's going to be something that you're adequate to do right now. So your spiritual guidance is not going to be asking you to do something you can't do right now, because in reality, the only time there is now. So any consciousness that is truly evolved is going to always get you to do things in your point of power, and the present is your point of power. If you're going to make any changes in your life, you can only do it now. So true guidance is going to be about what you can do now. And then the Course says your ego guidance, your false guidance, is going to always direct you to something you can't do now. Even if you were doing something now in order to create something in the future, you're still doing what you can do now. You see what I'm saying? So it's important to recognize that that which created us is intelligent enough to only ask us to do what we can do and what we're willing to do, because that's what a smart mind would do. If I'm smart, I'm going to ask my brother here to do what he's willing to do and what he's able to do. I'm not going to set up a bunch of propositions for my brother that he doesn't want to do and that he can't do. So when you're like struggling over, is this my guidance? Is it really coming from God? I don't know. Well, it ain't. How do I know? Because I don't feel adequate to do it. I don't feel inspired to do it. And it doesn't seem like something I can do. Now, there could be a lot of yes buts. Yes but, yes but, yes but, yes but, yes but. That's fine. Use your yes but. Do you? Yes, because you don't have to do anything I'm saying, right? But keep this in mind. It's easier to have communication between you and your higher self if you decide on or agree on how you're going to have that communication. You know what I'm saying? It's like if I say, whenever you see me raise my hand, then that means that I want you to stop talking for a minute and I want you to listen to what I have to say. Okay? Then what we just did was establish communication. So you know when I raise my hand that you need to pause and listen. That's all I'm saying. You could make an agreement with your higher self that the instructions that you receive from it would be simple and clear and something you could do right now. That could be your agreement. And then your communication would be that way. Now, if you're a person who needs complication, and some people do, they feel like unless it's all complicated as hell, then it can't be real. There are people who would come to a class like this and hate it because I'm talking very simple concepts. And they want me to talk about all the different chakras and all the different dimensions of reality and all the probabilities and all the light beings and all the light sides. And that's cool too. That's fun. I have a great time with that myself. But then there are also a bunch of people that's going, you know what? I want it simple, I want it fast, and how I can do it right now. And that's what the Course in Miracles is. So if you establish with your higher self what the communication will be like, then you can start to receive guidance from yourself. My guidance is that if it's something you want me to do, that it will be easy and flowing and I can do it, and the way to do it will present itself and I can really just show up as who I am and do it. That's my agreement with the Holy Spirit. So that's the way things show up for me. If it's something I'm supposed to do, usually it'll show up very easily. The way to do it will show up very easily. The support to do it will show up very easily. And in the end, all I have to do is show up. Like when I went to Europe to speak, it was like, we want you to speak, but we'll pay for you to come here. We'll pay for you to come. We'll provide you a place to stay. We'll meet you at the airport when you show up. We're going to take you out to dinner. And by the way, do you mind going to Paris? What did I have to do? I had to show up to do me. I had to show up as me, to share the Course in Miracles, to share, and that came from putting a video on YouTube, okay? So that's the way things come to me unless I decide that I don't deserve it, and then I sabotage myself and I create drama and problems for myself out of my own lack of belief that I deserve to have it. So there are sometimes I trip myself up because it's just too good for what I believe I deserve for myself. Because I have my layers of shadow that thinks I'm not enough. So sometimes it gets so good, even I go, oh, hell no, I can't let this happen. I'm going to do something. I'm going to do something really dumb right now to get rid of this because it's just too good. Anybody relate to what I'm saying? Yeah. You know, it just gets too good. The next thing you know you're doing, and you know it. And you can't even stop yourself. No. You go, I'm getting ready to do something stupid. And then you just go right ahead and you do it. It's just as stupid as hell. But you know it's your way of stopping that good because it's too big of a threat. Yeah. To your idea about yourself, which is that you don't deserve to have it. So you're most likely to attack the person who's treating you the kindest when you reach your limit about how much love you think you deserve.
Yeah.
You try to get rid of all the people who treat you kindly. You try to get rid of everybody who cares about you. You'll be picking fights left and right trying to get rid of the people who care more about you than you care about yourself. That's deep. I saw somebody had a hand up over there. Did you have your hand up over there?
I did. I think you've got it. I'd like to ask it anyway.
Sure.
You said willing.
Willing.
And the minute you said willing, I'm thinking ego. Mm-hmm. And seeing ego interfering mm-hmm. with receiving that communication. Mm-hmm. But I haven't digested what you just said. So I don't want ego to get in the place of being willing, in the way of getting willing.
Right, right. So how do I keep my ego from getting in the way of being willing? Doing as much as I can to increase my belief that I deserve to have it.
Oh.
How do I increase my belief that I deserve to have it? Well, the same way I increase my belief that I don't deserve to have it. Well, how was that? Through repetition. Through what I was telling myself in the conversations in my mind, through what I was listening to from what everybody else was saying. See, most people don't realize that perception is learning, that they're seeing things the way they learn to see it, that there is no separation between perception and learning. You learn to think of me as a black man named Earl Purdy just sitting in the chair. If you had learned to look at me as a rabbit, and that was what, and then you would come in and say, that was the coolest lesson that rabbit gave this morning. That black rabbit gave the coolest class you've ever seen in your life. You know what I'm saying? And everybody would feel okay because we learned to call me a rabbit. So the Course is saying something that radical, that you don't realize you're just reacting to what you've learned, and it may not be true. And then he says, well, how do you know it's not true? Because you don't feel love, and you don't feel peace, and you don't feel happiness. That's how you know what you learned isn't true. The way you know what you've learned isn't true is how you feel. And the truth gives you a feeling of peace, and what's not true gives you feelings of fear. It's really that simple. So many times it's hard to admit that because the person would have to admit that 99% of their life is not based on anything true. They have to say, well, I'm wrong about everything based on what you just said. You are wrong about everything. And the sooner you recognize you are wrong about everything, that's when you're going to be happy. So you have to ask yourself, do I want to be right or do I want to be happy? I'd rather be happy. I'm like somebody was saying to me the other day about something I was saying, and I was saying, I hope I'm wrong about it. I don't want to be right about it. I hope you're right. I don't want to be right about something that makes me miserable. You know, if I say I don't think you like me, I want to be wrong about that. I don't want to be right about that. So I walk up to you and say, boy, I hope I'm wrong about this, but it seems like I really irritate you some kind of way. What is it that we could do about that? Because I don't want to be right about that perception. Is that true? Then they might say, well, you're right about that perception. I don't like you. Okay, then at that point, then I have to ask myself, how do I want to make myself feel about it? Because I'm not going to try to change you, but what I can do is change the way that I feel about what you just said about me. You know, and one of the toughest areas of the workshop that I did yesterday was you could almost like feel a pin drop in the room. It was so intense. because I wanted to show people the power of how you give things meaning, and that if you choose not to give something meaning, it doesn't have effect on you. So I asked the person in the room to call me a nigger, and I asked them to call me a nigger 5 times. They almost died.
Yeah.
It was like he went, and I was saying, and I said, you have to realize, I'm asking you to call me that because there's a lesson I want to teach myself about not making that word matter to me. If you really care about me, you'll listen to what I'm saying. I'm asking you to say it. That's different from you saying it out of a sense of malice and separation. I'm telling you, I don't want a word to affect me. I don't want that word to have any effect on me. Now, one of the ways I don't want that word, I'm going to show that I don't want that word to have an effect on me, is I'm going to get the person to say it that's supposed to give me the greatest charge saying it, a white male. So you can walk this stuff, and you can talk this stuff, and you can walk this stuff. You can try to apply the truth, and you can keep reading and studying it all the time. That's okay, but if you're a reader and a studier and not a liver, you're going to get bored, and you're going to get frustrated, and you're going to drop it. Because you're going to think you're doing it, but you're not doing nothing but reading it, thinking it, talking it. But you're not doing it. Now, the reading and thinking and talking it is important because you got to get the theory in your mind. But unless you actually start applying it, you'll never see it work in your life. And then you become one of these people that we call the collectors. A collector is someone who just jumps from workshop to workshop, book to book, collecting books and collecting workshop material and collecting information. I call them collectors. And I actually think collecting is the same as studying. It's like a person who says they're going to build a house. They go to the hardware store and get a bunch of nails and get a bunch of hammers, right, and wood, and they throw it on the floor and they wait for the house to get built. And they're sitting there going, there's the hammer, there's the wood. Where's the house? Then they go, I know what the problem is. They go back to the hardware store and buy some more hammers and some more nails. But they're not never building anything. So if you're a collector, if you're a great reader of truth, and you read books all the time, and you go to workshops all the time, and you can point out, you should be reading this, and you should be reading this, you're a collector. If you're not applying any of it, you're a collector. How can you know for sure if you're a collector and not a practitioner? Good question, right? Because you can tell by the way you handle upset. The way a person handles upset is more of a determiner of their level of consciousness than the way they handle peaceful situations. I can talk taking responsibility all day long, but when something upsets me and I go, it's your fault, you doggone it, you doing it to me again, you always doing this, you always making me mad, well see, that's my level of consciousness. I can talk all this stuff when I felt cool, but when I got upset, I started blaming, that's my level of consciousness, I'm still asleep. But if I got upset and went, oh, here I go again, I'm making myself upset right now, I'm the one giving this all the meaning it has for me, I'm the one that's making myself so mad right now, I'm the one that's making me want to smack them upside their head right now, I'm the one that's doing it. See, then I'm applying my truth in an upsetting situation, which means it really is something that's beginning to take root in me. But if I only apply my truth when I'm happy, I'm kidding, I'm jabbing. But as many as something goes wrong, I get laid off my job, I go, oh, it's the economy. We got to get rid of whoever that president or whatever's going on. Then I'm not a conscious being, because a conscious being knows that it has nothing to do with the economy. It has to do with their own consciousness. You see what I'm saying? So did you go, I got laid off, and then you told yourself, I do not receive my own best interests. One door shuts, another door opens. This is an opportunity that God is opening up for me to have something even better than I just left. Okay, then I really do believe what I'm learning. But if I go, they laid me off, the boss didn't like me, the economy is bad, then you're just as asleep as everybody else who's never picked up a book. Because the people who never picked up a book are going to say that. The people who've never studied are going to say it's the problem is that affirmative action. But whatever outer thing that we come up with is a justification for the feeling we've already decided to have. Because that's what we do. We decide how to feel, then we create the situations that justify it. I decide to feel bad, then I create the relationship that gives me a hard time. I decide to experience lack, then I make poor financial choices. They come after the decision. The decision comes first. Then everything justifies it. Deep. Deep, 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 deep. And I'm saying, yes.
How do you make your decision more conscious?
By consciously making it. You know, it means getting up in the morning saying, I am holy, I am complete, I am the holy child of God. The problem is that people think they need to believe it first. And they don't realize that the first stage of accepting any new idea is the repetition of it. And then when you repeat it enough, you begin to accept that it's true. And so it's not about the first time you say you're whole and perfect, feeling, oh my God, I said it one time and I feel whole and I feel perfect. No, it's like reminding yourself over and over again. Now, this is the cool part though. If it's the truth, then it's gonna work faster because the universe is supporting that idea also. So you really are whole and complete, Jody. So therefore, when you start saying it, you're just going into agreement with something that's already true. And since you're trying to go into agreement with something that's already true, that you are loved and that you are lovable, it manifests faster. But if you want to believe that you are not enough, you have to do that by yourself. Because love is not supporting that idea. The universe really isn't supporting that idea. That's why people strive to really keep a grievance and remember what they got the grievance about in order to keep the grievance going. Because if not, they forget what they're mad about. You know what I'm saying? That's why you have to keep being reminded so you can stay angry at the person. That's what journals are for. You know, so you get a chance to go back to your diary. I was just about to forgive them. Let me go back. What was it? Oh, I know. On June the 10th, 2009. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Okay, now I'm back to it. Because if not, you forget it. Because time has erased the thing that you're using time to hold on to. And so what I'm saying to you is that you're whole and complete and beautiful and innocent and you deserve to be happy. If that upsets you, then I'm a problem for you. You might have beliefs that keep you from knowing that, and you could change your mind and let those beliefs go. There are a million different paths and ways to do it, not just A Course in Miracles. You did not create yourself, so therefore you have divine guidance that's available to you to get you past it. So the only thing I want to throw out to you today, are you ready for the end of sickness? Are you ready for the end of your conflict?
I'm ready.
Are you ready for the end of
I'm
your
ready.
Fear?
Yeah.
And if you are ready, then you know that the teacher is going to show up when the pupil is ready. So the synchronicities and the support that you want are going to naturally show up if you are supported. I'm here to support you any way that I can. I do a class on Tuesday night that's called The Art of Intimacy, Creating Fulfilling Happy Relationships. And right now we're going through sex and sexuality and the expression of that and removing the blocks of that and understanding what sacred sexuality is, as well as good old lusty sexuality and how that works. So it's a class for people who are spiritual and horny, as well as people who are not and wish they were, as well as people who want to use sex as a tool of awakening and creating true intimacy within themselves. It really covers the spectrum, and it was intense last Tuesday. It was great. I enjoyed it so much, you know. So I'm going to be myself, and I'm here to support you, and I'm here to love you, and that's what you deserve. So I'd like to ask you to acknowledge yourself right now for being willing to hear another episode of The Black Man Rants. It's a very important class. All right, so what we're going to do now, I'm a full-time teacher, and I'm going to do a financial appreciation offering. And if you would like to share, because you felt like what you received today was of value to you, I would really appreciate that. On the internet, those of you listening on the internet, thank you for your support on every level. And remember, I'm available for personal sessions called Clarity Sessions. If you go to my website, earlpurdy.com, it explains what they are. And that's me working with you on a one-on-one to get past any block.
They're great.
They are. Woo! They're so good.
Yeah, so just want to put that out there to you. And thank you for sharing with me. And believe me, it's not charity. It's not charity. I believe I shared today and you received today, hopefully. So thank you for sharing with me. You are innocent, you are powerful, you are loving. You're getting ready to go out into the lab. Everybody that's in your experience right there, right now, is either helping you recognize your power or they're helping you recognize what you think of as your weakness. The purpose of any kind of partnership or relationship is to get you in touch with the aspects of yourself that you are not seeing, that you need to notice and get become aware of. Everybody in your life is there to help you, whether they even realize it or not. And I'm saying you deserve happiness. So I'm going to end this today by saying four powerful words from A Course in Miracles, which is abundance is my natural state. Abundance is your natural state. There's no need for lack in any area of your life. Are you open to having abundance in every way?
Yes.
Is anybody in here open to having abundance in every way? Are you willing to have abundance in every way? Are you willing to have abundance of love and abundance of joy and abundance of peace and abundance of abundance? Are you willing? Okay, here we go. We'll give you 1 minute together and we're gonna do this. Here we go. Abundance is your natural state. Abundance is my natural state. Abundance is my natural state. Abundance is. So I'm gonna say it for you. Abundance is your natural state. You deserve abundance. Deserve abundance. You deserve love. You deserve peace. You deserve joy. You deserve freedom. You deserve life. You deserve kindness. You deserve peace. You deserve peace. You deserve fun. You deserve fun. You deserve support. You deserve support. You deserve safety. You deserve safety. You deserve God. You deserve God. You deserve the truth. You deserve the truth. It's the truth about you. The truth about you.
You practice what you preach, and would you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us.
So we're going to see if we can get a few people that can tell mind that they join with me and say, abundance is my natural state. 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 Abundance is your natural state. Abundance is your natural state. I'm willing to be abundant. I am willing to be abundant. I am willing to be abundant. Is there anyone that doesn't mind saying it aloud? I am willing to be abundant. What? I'm willing to be abundant. Say what? I'm willing to be abundant. Yeah, I'm willing. Be abundant, and I'm juicy and sweet. I am juicy and sweet. I am rich and abundant. I am loving and lovable. I deserve love. Willing to accept love. I am willing to accept love right now. See y'all next week. Appreciate y'all.
That's getting it in your body. You gotta get some funk in there. You gotta get some funk in there so you can have it happen, right?
Yeah. I appreciate y'all. Hugs are available and I love you. Woke you up a little bit.